Polinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Clair-de-Lune, written by Cassandra Goles and read by Stanley McGeagh. The dedication reads, For Jonathan Shaw. The Girl Who Could Not Speak. Once upon a time, 100 years ago, and half as many years again, there lived a girl called Clair-de-Lune who could not speak. She lived with her grandmother in an attic at the top of a very tall, very narrow, very old building, with 6 floors and 12 rickety stairways climbing up and down precariously between them. They were very poor, but they were also very gentil, which means that Clair-de-Lune's grandmother thought a good deal about table manners and ladylike behaviour, and would rather starve than be thought ill-mannered. In winter, the attic was cold, and the wind blew through the cracks around the window panes, and snow floated in through the ceiling. But in spring and summer, the sparrows and the swallows and the doves and the pigeons flew in flocks past the attic windows, and Clair-de-Lune would wake in the morning to the strange, lovely sound of their wings beating against their breasts. Clair-de-Lune's grandmother had been a ballerina, and so had Clair-de-Lune's mother. So it will not surprise you when I say that Clair-de-Lune spent every morning, Monday to Saturday, in a large, long room 3 floors below, with 24 other girls and boys, and a strict ballet master by the name of Monsieur Dupont, for she was learning to be a dancer too. In the afternoons, she studied geography and history and French and Italian, and went to the market for her grandmother, who was very frail, although as slim and straight-backed as a young tree, and rarely moved from the attic. On Sundays, Clair-de-Lune went to church, where she opened her mouth in time with the music, but did not sing. Why was it that Clair-de-Lune could not speak? Ah, nobody knew. But Clair-de-Lune's mother had died when she was a baby, and it was thought to have something to do with that. Clair-de-Lune's mother, who had been known as La Lune, which means the moon, had been much celebrated for a famous pas seul, which came at the end of a tragic and beautiful ballet about swans, who, it is said, are mute until the very last moments of their lives, when they give forth the most lovely of all songs. Many years before the first performance of Swan Lake, and many years more before Anna Pavlova conquered the world with the dying swan, La Lune danced the role of a swan mortally wounded by the crossbow of a hunter. In a long white tutu, made of layers and layers of tulle and swan's feathers. And though La Lune made no sound, as dancers do not, there was one night when all the audience swore that she was singing the most unearthly song, as if her dancing was so beautiful that you could hear it. On that night, when she sank to the boards at the end of her pas seul, folding herself like a bird, she rested her head amongst the tulle and the feathers of her skirt, and did not rise again.
Brava, brava!
Came the shouts from the audience, whose clapping and cheering were like thunder. At first, no one understood that anything was wrong. It was some moments before the audience, at first uncertain, grew quiet, before the curtains were drawn hurriedly, and a doctor called, before the audience began to whisper, then to murmur among themselves. Then came the announcement, the head of the company in tears.
Ladies and gentlemen, La Lune is dead. The doctor says her heart was weak, too weak for her to dance. If only we had known.
And the sobs of the audience and the flowers which poured in from all over the country for weeks. Some who were backstage on the night La Lune died said it was not singing they heard, but speech, that La Lune, the mute swan, the ballerina, had died trying to say something. As for Clair-de-Lune, Well, La Lune's public did not even know she existed. But she too was backstage that night, and though she was only a tiny baby, she must have understood something. For from that day to this, she had never uttered a word. Did Clair-de-Lune mind about not speaking? Ah, reader, it seemed to her that as each day passed, the weight of things unsaid grew heavier and heavier on her heart. Clair-de-Lune cries as if her heart would break. Every morning, come rain or sunshine, even in winter when the snow lay on the ground, Clair-de-Lune would kneel on the window seat, push open the casement, lean her elbows on the windowsill, and gaze out of the attic, trying to speak. Sometimes, when the sun was shining, or even in the gentle rain, she would feel happy while she was doing this, because there was a kind of peace in looking out the window, a kind of privacy. Suddenly she was alone with the view, and the view almost seemed to look back at her, liking her, and not minding that she was mute. But most often she was sad, because she longed to be able to speak, and yet no matter how much she longed, no matter how hard she tried, no words came. She would sit gazing out at the acres and acres of browny red rooftops, for that was all that could be seen from the attic window, browny red slate roofs, sloping unevenly, and drain pipes, a steeple in the distance, a black cat picking its way over the roof opposite, chimneys, pigeons, sparrows, swallows, doves, and a small blue square, on sunny days, which was the sky. And as she gazed, she would be overwhelmed by longing, until the tears pricked at her eyes and overflowed, and the red roofs swam together. And then her grandmother would call her to hurry up and finish dressing, for she must be at her class by 9 o'clock, and she would pull in her head and obey. To class every morning, Clair-de-Lune wore rose-pink stockings and practice shoes and a sharply waisted white muslin practice dress with matching pantalettes, which extended 3 inches below the hem of her calf-length skirt. A black sash went around her waist. The dress was décolleté, that is, it left her throat and shoulders bare, and like all the other girls, she parted her hair in the middle and smoothed it back modestly into a chignon which rested on the nape of her neck. A black snood kept her hair in check. The whole ensemble was a compromise between modesty and a very real, practical need to see as much as possible of what the limbs and body were doing during a ballet class. Modesty had prevailed, however. Clair-de-Lune was learning to dance en pointe, and she carried her pointe shoes with her to class in a threadbare little reticule, together with a clean handkerchief. She had blocked the shoes herself, as dancers did in those days, with extra stitching and starched muslin wrapped around her toes. When it was cold, she wore her mother's warm woolen pelisse to and from class. Fortunately, because the school was held in the same building 3 floors below, she need not go outside. Breakfast each morning was the same. Bread, a scrape of chocolate, and milk coffee heated in a saucepan on the little pot-bellied stove. There was never quite enough to eat, and not surprisingly, Clair-de-Lune and her grandmother were both very thin.
"Sit up straight, child," Clair-de-Lune's grandmother would say. "Remember, your back should not touch the chair."
And then it would be time to leave. Every morning, Clair-de-Lune would make her way down 6 flights of steps, 2 for each floor, and wonder, as she passed each doorway, what lay behind it. On the 4th floor, there lived an opera singer, a baritone, and often, although not early in the morning, Clair-de-Lune would hear him singing his scales or practicing an aria. The building had many actors and dancers and singers and artists living in it, but it was large and complicated, and Clair-de-Lune knew that many of its people and much of its comings and goings were a mystery to her. Just how much of a mystery she was yet to find out. All the way down the last 4 flights of steps, more and more clearly as she approached, Clair-de-Lune could hear the ballet school's pianist warming up. He wore grey woolen gloves with the fingers snipped out of them as he played, because his hands were always cold. Depending on the season, and if the day was going to be a sunny one, there would be warm, bright patches of sunlight in the dusty windows of the landings between the stairways. In one of these, arranged gracefully, with an eye to the possibility of passing portrait painters, or so it seemed, Clair-de-Lune would often encounter elderly Mrs. Costello's Minette, who would purr with immediate rapture when stroked, shutting her green eyes with a sort of regal gratitude. Then, as Clair-de-Lune rounded the corner and began to descend the last flight, she would come upon the large double doorway with the stern sign on the wall beside it. Monsieur Dupont's Select a Dancing Academy for the children of artists who aspire to enter their parents' profession. Girls and boys milled around it as they arrived for the morning. Girls in rose-pink stockings and white practice frocks, boys in calf-length black breeches, black belts and short white muslin vests. And always at this point, Clair-de-Lune's heart would quail. And sometimes it was all she could do to keep her feet going in the school's direction, so strongly that they seemed to want her to turn and retreat back up the stairs. But on she would go, just a little more slowly at first, and then quickly, as she ducked her head and squeezed past them through the doorway.
"Snob,"
one of the girls, usually Millie Twinkenham, who had bright red hair and nut-brown eyes, would murmur.
"Won't talk, just because her mother was Lalune."
For in all the class, Clair-de-Lune had not one friend. But inside it was easier. Clair-de-Lune did not like to arrive early, while everyone was still chatting, for of course she wasn't able to explain why she could not. She always tried to reach the door just at the moment Monsieur Dupont called his class to order, from which point there was always complete, disciplined silence. Then, quiet like the others, she would scuttle to the bar and wait in first position for Monsieur Dupont to begin the class.
"Attention, s'il vous plaît, mesdames, messieurs," he would say. "We shall commence, of course, with pliés. First position. Draw yourselves up, tails tucked under, tummies pulled in, heads erect, and..."
Monsieur Dupont was a thin, small man who seemed to live on medicinal tea, which steamed in his cup throughout his classes and filled the room with a faint herbal scent. He often behaved as if he was teaching through a splitting headache, as if everything was too much for him and the world a dreadful place. But as the class wore on, he would become more and more cheerful, a little grudgingly at first, and then as if he had forgotten what he was annoyed about. He tried not to show it, but in fact he had a very soft spot for Clair-de-Lune, as he had danced with her mother, and every day would see a little movement or an attitude of the head or arms that reminded him of her. He often stole secret, proud glances in her direction, for he felt convinced that one day she would be a great dancer like her mother and grandmother, and he would be remembered as her teacher. And indeed, Clair-de-Lune loved to dance. She loved the long, dusty wooden room, its walls covered in mirrors. She loved the sight of the long bar suspended along the sides and the feel of it in her hands. She loved the strict, precise sound of Monsieur Dupont's voice as he counted time, or stopped the music to scold them, and then to demonstrate exquisitely how something should be done. She loved to move, to work, until her limbs were warm and supple and her face glowing. But most of all, Clair-de-Lune loved dancing because it was a way to speak, even if you could not speak. She could not speak with her lips and her tongue and her mouth, it was true. She could not speak with her voice. But when she was dancing, her arms and legs spoke, and her hands and feet spoke, and her body and the carriage of her head spoke too. And she felt that just a little of the weight on her heart, the weight of things unsaid, would be lifted. Ah, but what is dance without music? If it were possible, Clair-de-Lune loved music even more than dance, for she knew that without it, none of these other things could have happened. The school's pianist was a poor young music student with a thin, haggard face and dark eyes. He played patiently through all the exercises, keeping strict time and stopping and starting whenever Monsieur Dupont required. But at the end of each morning's class, he would play beautiful music just for the love of it, as everyone collected their things, said goodbye, and left. And Clair-de-Lune would linger unnoticed in order to hear it to the end. On one particular morning, as the class ended, when each girl had made her reverence and each boy his salut, and Monsieur Dupont had dismissed them, young Mr. Sparrow, the pianist, began to play the most beautiful music Clair-de-Lune had ever heard. And because of this, something happened. In fact, because of this, many things happened. At first, so that she could listen, she sat on the floor, pretending to fuss with the ribbons which tied up her shoes, crossing and recrossing them. But soon she forgot to pretend to do anything. As Mr. Sparrow continued to play more and more beautifully, she slowly let go of the ribbon, sat forward, rose to her feet, then crept across the room to the piano. For it seemed to Clair-de-Lune that the music was filled with longing, a longing so gentle and yet so intense that it would break her heart. It seemed to be asking something from her which she, in turn, longed to give, and yet she didn't know what it was or how to give it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.